You know, it's not easy preparing a message to give to a group, especially every week. And it's even harder when you have a full-time job. Now I get to share the message maybe 8 times a year. And I'm exhausted by the time I do it. For our church, I got to share every other week for a 6-week period, and it's like my mind could barely think after that. Your pastor does it every week. He has a full-time job, but he still finds time to counsel. He still finds time to pray. He still finds time to prepare a message given to him by God. So Joe, I thank you for letting me speak tonight, because it was on my heart to share this message. And Joe called me when I was on a flight to Dallas last week. I said, hey, when I finally got in touch with him, he said, can you speak? And it was like an answer to my prayer, and it's an answer to his prayer. But Joe, I hope you've had a chance to rest this week and be renewed by God, because you're back in the breach next week. All right. And like I said, I do have a selfish reason for wanting to talk tonight. Next Saturday, we're going out on the road, and we're going out to Oakland, California. We're going to be staying in Vallejo, and I think it's going to be a fun time for everybody, but it is going to be very different. And the focus is going to be sharing the gospel message, engaging in intentional conversations, and doing random acts of kindness and service, right? But all of it's tied making Jesus known and making people know him. So keep us in your prayer. All right, so in this short story, The Capital of the World, Ernest Hemingway tells the story of a Spanish father and his teenage son. The relationship between the father and son is strained at best and finally becomes shattered. The rebellious son named Paco, a common Spanish name, ran away from home. The father searched for his son for a long time, but he could not find him. So finally he took out an ad in a Madrid newspaper, hoping his son would see it and respond. The ad simply read, "Dear Paco, please meet me in front of the newspaper office at noon. All is forgiven. Love, Father." As Hemingway tells the story, the next day at noon in front of the newspaper office, there were 800 Pacos, all seeking forgiveness from their fathers. Ernest Hemingway's story reveals an important truth of life. Most people want to be connected to the people they love and to their families, even after they've gone out of their way to damage the relationship. They want to be part of it. Most still want to be reconciled back together. Every year at World Changers, we have a focus verse, and some of the students were wearing the shirt from last year. We've been calling it the billboard, because this one's pretty, it's like wearing a billboard on your chest. But what it says, reconcile. It's the 2 Corinthians 5:17 through 21. And that's what we're going to be talking about tonight. We're going to be talking about reconciliation and being reconciled back to God, and how we have now become God's ambassadors to the world. So if you have your Bibles, please turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and we'll start in verse 14, and we'll read tonight's story. Beginning in verse 14. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone, the new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself in Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors through God, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you, on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for the day. I thank you for the chance to be here and just to worship you, Lord, and to hear your word, God. Lord, it's such a joy every time we hear your word spoken or read. And I thank you, Father, for the opportunity that you've given me to share this message tonight. I pray, Lord, that you would, that people would hear your voice. I am just your messenger, God. It is your message. So I lift it up to you, God. I just pray that you would direct all of us, that we would hear what you want us to hear. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, so let's dive into the text a little bit. All right, so 2 Corinthians 5:14-15. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. The key word in that verse is compels. Compels is not something that can. No, compels is an urgent, driving force. You cannot stop. All right, no matter what happens. When I am compelled, I will go to whatever lengths it takes to get the job done. Yeah. And that's what he's saying here. Paul says, for Christ's love compels us. It has to be the driving force to get us to do all the things that we need to do. And it gets to the point where we can't contain this love that Christ has put inside us, or we'll bust. How many of you guys have ever felt like, I'm going to explode if I can't get it out? Maybe not about this message, but maybe about something else. Somebody shared a story with you. Hopefully it wasn't a secret. Hopefully you keep that quiet. Okay? But you've been told something and you just want to go and share it. I remember when my kids were first found out my wife was gonna have kids. It's like, I want to tell everybody. I'm going to be a father. That's the feeling that we have here. And we were convinced that one died for all. And who was the one? Jesus Christ. The only one that was able to die for everybody. We share the act of love that Jesus did for us by dying on the cross for forgiveness of our sins. We are part of that now. When we come to know Jesus Christ, we are part of that act that he did. For we are convinced, and not just maybe, but we're certain of his death and its purpose. We know why he died on the cross. If you don't know, I'm going to tell you right now. It's for the forgiveness of your sins, that they will not be held against you any longer. And I'm jumping way ahead of myself, so this service might go real fast. All right? That's the point. We are certain about what he did and what it means to our lives. Verse 15 says, and he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. And this is a controversial verse, because it says, and he died for all. Did he die for everybody? Or did he die just for those that believe? I'm not a theologian, so I can't give you a really strong argument for any positions. But it will say this. Scripture says he died for all. That is good enough for me. He died for everyone. But it doesn't mean that his death is effective for everyone, as sad as that may be. If you don't accept Jesus Christ, if you don't have him as Lord of your life, that death that takes away your sins, that resurrection that gives you new life, it's not going to apply to you. That's how I read the scripture. But it does say right there that he died for all. So I'm going to take it and stand on that. He died for everybody. Well, again, jumping ahead of myself, if he died for everybody, we got to make sure they know. We got to make sure they know. Verses 15 and 16. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. We have to see people now. Now that we've been given this great gift and we know Christ, we have to see people in a different way. We have new eyes.
Right.
We have to put on our spiritual glasses and filter through Jesus Christ. How many of you guys remember the old 3D glasses in the movies? You know, when you went to see the movies? Well, I have a 3D video player. So I have these cool glasses. And now you guys all look different. Way blurrier than they did before. But I'm seeing you through a filter. I'm seeing you through something else. When I take and put on Jesus Christ, what do I see? I don't see a bunch of people that are worthless. I don't see a bunch of people that are not worth dying for. So when I look now, I see those that Christ died for. As I wear these special glasses, and you can get them for $9.95. When I wear these glasses, when I put on those eyes, I see a world that's hurting. I see a world that needs Jesus Christ. I can't look at people like I used to. And trust me, there are many times that I want to. There are many times that I would just as soon go on right on by. I'm tired, I'm busy, whatever it may be. I can't look that way. Scripture tells me I can't look that way. I have to be different. I have to look at everybody. Because you know what? Everybody is guilty. The only difference between everybody and us? We've been told the message, and we've accepted it. And so now our sins are forgiven. So don't sit and rest in your salvation. That's not what God intended. We should be looking at everybody. When we look out these doors and the people that drive you by, we should look at all of them as possible co-heirs with Jesus Christ, as brothers and sisters to us. There will be some people driving by or walking by that may already believe in Jesus Christ. But there's going to be many, many, many that go by that don't. We need to be praying for those people. We need to be intentional about that. We don't know who's going to believe our message. When we share, we don't know what impact it's going to have. But we know that our message has to get out there. Again, this I'm real happy about being able to speak today because this is the message that we're taking to Oakland next week. This is our purpose of going. So verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here. We're a new creation when we come to faith in Christ. Gone is the lust, the greed, the evil desires, the jealousy, the coveting, all of that stuff is gone. And maybe not immediately removed from our heart. I don't know about you guys, but I've been in Christ for 21 years now, and I still have some things that I try to let go of. I try to pick back up and take back. Sin still comes into our life. But the forgiveness of sin is held. And it's not held against me anymore. We are new, a pure and spotless creation before God, washed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Verse 18, all this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Who did this come from? It came from you, and from you, and from you. That's not what the scripture says. Where'd it come from? It came from God. So before we puff ourselves up, before we think that we're really something, because we've got salvation, we didn't do anything. We need to be on our knees and going, thank you, Lord. Because he gave us reconciliation. He initiated. Reconciliation, what does it mean to be reconciled? To be reconciled means to cause people or a group to become friendly after an argument or a disagreement. But you know what? God had his creation, and he put Adam and Eve in the garden. They had a disagreement. They couldn't agree to follow the rules that God had set before them. And so this argument, this disagreement separated them. and for years and years and years, they were separated. But Jesus came and died on the cross. We've been reconciled to God. We've been brought back. That's what happens. Our sin is forgiven, and now we have fellowship with God again. Verse 19 says that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ. And that's a key. It's in Christ. It's not in anyone else. It's not in any other God. It is in Christ. That's what we believe is what the Bible tells us. And it's the Word of God. We believe it. We stand on it. So let's not let that get away from us. He's reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. What's it mean to not counting people's sins against them? The King James Version uses the word imputing, okay, or imputing. It's an accounting term. And you have debits and credits. And guess what? Before we come to Jesus Christ, we have all of this debt that we cannot pay back. But when Christ came and died on the cross, the debt was paid. All right? He's not counting our sins against us anymore because Jesus wiped the slate clean. It's completely free. In fact, we're on the plus side now because we stand in Jesus Christ. Lives are different. The debt we owed was paid by Jesus and our account balance is at zero. Guess what? All future debt. When I sin tomorrow, when someone makes me mad at work and I say, it's forgiven already. I haven't done it yet, but God's already forgiven it. Because I love Jesus Christ and I've made him my Lord and Savior. Too many of us walk around thinking that, oh, I'm not worthy. Well, in a lot of respects you are. None of us are. But because of Jesus Christ, because of his death on the cross, we're completely worthy. And that's the way God sees us. That's how his reconciliation happens. That's how we can come back to him. Not by anything you did, but by all that what God did for you through his son, Jesus Christ. How about you? This is great news.
Amen.
All right, I'm excited about this. You know, if I loan Caitlin or borrow from Caitlin $10, I owe her money. Someday she's going to, and she's a young student, so she's going to probably hunt me down and say, where's my $10? At some point I'll have to pay her back. But you know what? God's not going to come to me and say, what about this debt you owe? Because the debt is paid. It's already taken care of. So he has reconciled me back to him, to where I can come before him. In Romans 5:8 it says, but God demonstrates his love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. While we were still sinners, the work was done. When Jesus was on the cross and said, it is finished, he meant it. Mm-hmm. It wasn't, well, maybe it's finished and it'll come back later. No, it's finished, it's done. Don't worry about it. It's paid off. We don't have to worry about it ever again. Mm-hmm. So if you're working real hard to try to pay for your debt, you don't need to. Jesus took care of it. Stop sinning. Stop doing the things that displease the Lord. And I say that to myself as much as to you guys, so I don't want to feel like you guys, you know, when you point a finger at somebody, look, I got three pointing back at me. All right, so I really want to say that. When I say to you guys, I'm saying to myself as well. So verse 20. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. We've been chosen. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you've been chosen to be an ambassador, to bring the message of reconciliation, to go out and tell the world you are separated from God, but you don't need to be. The debt's been paid. Come back. The Father wants to have relationship with you again. As we go out next week, guys, for the youth group, that's the message we want to send. Hey, you don't have to be apart from him anymore. We're ambassadors for the holy, eternal King. Mm-hmm. Does the title overwhelm you a little bit? Mm-hmm. It overwhelms me when I think I am an ambassador for God, mm-hmm. for Jesus Christ. Because I do tend to look at myself and say, there's nothing good about me. I see the sin in my life. You guys may not see it, but I know what's there. I know what's here. So, I struggle sometimes with, I'm an ambassador. God's given me this title. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm trying to live it as I owe him. I am his that he has chosen to send this world. So I'm trying very intentionally to try to figure out how do I go and be that ambassador for him. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't stand in my own right. I stand washed by the blood of Jesus, mm-hmm. pure and flawless.
Right.
And everyone is eligible to feel this way. But they won't. We don't share the truth. That's the sad part. If we don't tell them, they're never going to know. And they're never going to know the joy that we know. In verse 21, it says, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Paul reminds us it is about God's grace. God made him. It is not our doing. We, the ones who turned our backs on God, are made righteous again. Mm-hmm. Reconciled back to a relationship with God. I'm going to tell you guys, you don't look very happy about this. Yeah. This should be really exciting news. I know most of you know it already, but we should never let that joy stop showing in our faces. Mm-hmm. Stop showing in our lives and what we do. When you walk around sour all day, when you walk around failing to smile, what's the message you're sending? We do not want to send that message. I'll tell you what, Richard, if you come to me and you're crabbier than heck, I'm probably not going to listen to you. All right? So if I haven't accepted Christ, he's got no chance of sharing the message with me because he's a cranky guy. But he's not. I see the smile on his face right now. He's got joy in his heart. That's what we want to share with people. That's what we want to present to people as we go out. So as ambassadors of Christ, ministers of reconciliation, what should we do? Follow Matthew 28, the Great Commission. And I want to focus on just one word. Go. Everything else is great, but go. We're not supposed to just stand here. We're not supposed to sit in these seats. We have to go. We have to go share the message. Amen. And you know what? It goes more than just go. You've been chosen. You've been sent. There's an action that's happening here that someone else is initiating.
That's right.
All right? I didn't say go. I didn't say, Jim, go. No. Jesus said, Jim, go. All right? That's the deal. We gotta live up to that. Isaiah, when he's in... has this vision of the temple. He's sitting there. And then he says, I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? And I said, here I am. Send me. By a rhetorical, you know what a rhetorical question is, right? You don't have to answer it. So by a rhetorical show of hands, how many people have answered when he said, go, send me? That's what we need to get to. And I say rhetorical show of hands because I don't want to put anybody on the spot. But everybody should be able to say, yes, God has said, send me, and I'm going. I've gone. Isaiah didn't hesitate. He jumped right up and said, I'm ready. Send me. Let's look at somebody else that was sent. John the Baptist. Jesus says this. This is the one about whom it is written. I will send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way before you. He was talking about John the Baptist. Let's look at another one. Jesus sent out his disciples. He sent out the 72. And in Luke chapter 10, verses 2 and 3, he says, he told them, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. The Lord asked the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. And all of these words that you're seeing for send and sent are the same Greek word. It means someone has sent them out. Okay? In the New Testament, we see the church in Antioch worshiping and fasting when the Holy Spirit gives them instructions. And they have Barnabas and Paul with them, and they're getting ready to go on their very first missionary journey. And while they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. When we had our team up here and you guys were praying for us, we just did it. We took that first century scripture and we just lived it as a group. Again, you guys, this is good news. I mean, I'm sorry, I don't mean to be telling you bad stuff. This is good news. It should put a smile on our face. I'm going to get excited anytime I go, I just did what God called me to do. Amen. Hey, it was pretty easy. All you had to do was sit there. Now, you're going to have to go next week. You guys don't get to sit. All right. But more importantly, all these people that are being sent, how about this one? 1 John 4, 9 through 10. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. If Jesus had failed to go, you would have never heard this message. You wouldn't be sitting in these seats. Because Jesus was sent by his Father to reconcile us back to him, that we are now having this conversation.
Amen.
So praise God for what he did.
That's right.
And praise God, praise our Lord Jesus Christ, that he was faithful to do what his Father sent him to do. Amen. So if we are faithful to go when the Lord sends us, what is it that we hope to accomplish? That people will be saved, reconciled back to God, and receive eternal life. We're going to jump down to Romans. Romans chapter 10, verse 13. And Paul says, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. There's a promise there. Everyone that calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. But let's talk about this sending for just a minute. Paul lays out in the next two verses a very logical argument. Everybody that calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. But how the heck did they ever hear of the name of the Lord? Where did it come from? Romans, the next two verses, Romans 10, 14 through 15. How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? Is it making sense? Yeah. If we fail to get out of our seats and go tell somebody, we're never going to fill the seats. We're never going to see this world change to what it should be, which is a world devoted to God. And then the last part of that verse says, as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. Mm-hmm. So how are your feet? Mm-hmm. Is it time for you to have a spiritual pedicure? Do we need to pull out some files and brush them up and make them look good? Are you going out to share? Yesterday, as I was preparing this message, yet what I'm going to tell you next doesn't sound like I'm preparing a message, but as I was walking my dog, okay, because you need to take a break and think and pray and say, God, what are you really trying to tell me to say? As I'm walking my dog, I see these two young men come walking up the street. And they're both teenagers. And I see the interaction they're having with people in the house. I said, okay, these people are going door to door, these two guys. Well, it turns out that I met Ben and Todd, two 16-year-old men from Teen Challenge. Does anybody know who Teen Challenge is? They're a rehabilitation group. They're a drug rehab group. These two 16-year-old men fallen into drugs and addiction. And they had nowhere else to go. And a judge from two different states, one's from Washington, one's from Colorado, ordered them to go to Teen Challenge or go to jail. They chose to go to Teen Challenge. Both have become followers of Jesus Christ because of that decision. Ben, his dad is a pastor. But his relationship got so bad that they were totally estranged from one another. Could not have any relationship whatsoever. But the director at Teen Challenge took the time to share the gospel with him. And Ben said that, I asked Ben, and he said, I've always had plans. But until I accepted Jesus Christ, I had no hope. Now he has hope. His life is different. And since then, he's been reconciled back to his Father. Well, all those people walking down the street out there that don't know Christ have not been reconciled back to their Father.
Right.
That's our job.
That's right.
That's our jobs as ambassadors of Christ and ministers of reconciliation, is to share with them the word.
Amen.
So that they can go back. I got home after I was walking the dog, and I knew eventually these two would walk by my house. Eventually they did. And when Ben rang the doorbell, I stepped out. And I'd taken my hat off, and I didn't have my dog. And I closed the door and said, hi, Ben. And he went, how do you know my name? So I said, well, I met you earlier. So I told him, I said, you guys know you have beautiful feet? And they said, no. I said, well, I'm preparing this message, and this is the core text. I said, and you guys are walking around delivering the good news to everybody. You have beautiful feet. The Lord used this unexpected encounter yesterday to drive home the point for me of his work of reconciliation and what our role is in it. If the director of his center had not shared the gospel with Ben, he would not have that good news. He would not have beautiful feet. Well, I want to share some personal stories with you about people being sent. First, I'll share with you mine. I was not a believer in Jesus Christ. As I told you earlier, I've been a believer now for 21 years. If you do the math, you don't know how old I am, but you can figure it out. For 42 years, I was not a follower of Jesus Christ. Okay? Yeah, I got it. Okay. So, my brother, my twin brother, came from Colorado. Shared the good news with me. He was sent by God to tell me. But I didn't accept it. It took a year before I accepted Jesus Christ. Many times the first person that shares the gospel with us is not the person that opens our eyes to salvation when we accept Christ. But they still went, my brother still went and did exactly what God told him. Go and tell your brother. So I want to ask Jamie to come up here. Hi, Jamie.
Hi,
Jamie. All right, let me ask you just a couple questions. Are you a Christian?
Yes.
Okay. Who's the first person you remember sharing the gospel message with, to you?
My brother,
Joe.
This guy?
Yeah.
Okay. And did you accept when he shared it?
No.
Okay, how much longer did it take before you shared the gospel?
6 years.
6 years. Only took me one. That's it. We're done. Just an example of someone sharing, being sent. Well done, Joe. Being sent. And maybe other people came into Jamie's life, I would expect as well, and shared the message. Michael, can I get you to come up here for a minute? If you haven't noticed, I picked the two young adult leaders from our youth. I figured I'd put them on this one. Michael, are you a Christian?
Yes.
Who's the first person that you remember sharing the gospel message with you?
This youth leader from Awana named Ken.
Okay.
And my friend Bruce.
And? Okay. And did you accept Christ at the time?
No.
How long did it take before you accepted Christ?
3 years.
3 years with Pastor Julius. So, thank you. What I really hope you understand with that, this is a simply this. We go and share. And we worry about, are people going to accept it? Doesn't matter. Didn't say in the scripture that we are responsible for their salvation. We're responsible to go and tell them. And hopefully Joe goes and tells someone, and then Doug comes along and tells someone, then Nadine comes along and tells the same person. And maybe in about 10 or 12 episodes or interludes, whatever you want to call them, someone comes to Christ. But it takes all of these people going out and sharing that message. Amen. We are all called to go. Sometimes that means going to another country. My twin brother was a missionary. Deborah's son, Laker's son, is a missionary and called to a different country. Sometimes it means going to another state or another city. Hey guys, we're going to another state and another city. Good job. Sometimes it's another neighbor. Sometimes it's getting up and walking across the room and talking to the person that's sitting there in your house already. Those are some of the most uncomfortable conversations that we have because we don't want to cause a problem with our family, but we definitely need to make sure that they hear the message. So where is it that God wants to send you? I want to end my message tonight with an invitation to all of you. Is there someone in your life that you have been praying for? That maybe you have even shared the gospel message with, but did not get a positive response? Or maybe someone that you have felt the Holy Spirit sending you to, but you haven't yet gone. If you fit into that group, I'm gonna push your buttons a little bit here. I want you to stand up. If you have had someone that God has said, I want you to speak to you. But you haven't yet done it. Or you did not get a positive response from them. I ask you to stand up. So for those of you that are standing, what I want you to do is we're going to start here, and we're going to go around the room. And I just want you to say the first name out loud of the person that you are standing for right now. Because when we're done, we're going to pray as a group for those people.
My name is Freddie.
My prayer for this guy has been my friend she's the lovest.
Okay, Joe.
My brother JP.
Jamie.
My friend Jesse. Ayo.
For my daughter Carly.
For my sister Jess.
My mother-in-law Norma.
My mother Stella.
Vincent.
My grandma Susanna.
Kevin.
Victor.
My husband Gary.
My cousin Tom.
My mom and dad.
Now I did not take the time to memorize all those names. Doesn't matter. God knows those names. So we're going to pray for those people right now. Father God, we just lift up all of these people that we have been seeking out, that we have been sent to. Father God, we just lift them up to you. We pray that their moment of salvation will be near. Mm-hmm. That maybe the next time we share with them, that they would come to know you, Lord Jesus. Mm-hmm. Maybe the next time we give them the good news, that they would make the angels rejoice. So Father God, I thank you for these people that are willing to stand for their friends, to stand for their family, that are willing to go and be sent and do what they've been called to do. And God, I just pray that you watch over us. Watch over all of us as we go out to serve, as we go out to live our lives in joy because of you, God. I pray that you would bless us, that you would guide us, that you would help us to be those ambassadors of reconciliation, that you would help us to be pointed in what we say, and loving in how we give the message. And Lord, I just thank you again for the opportunity to speak tonight. And, we love you, Lord Jesus. We cannot thank you enough for what you have done for us. And we praise you, and we pray that you will be glorified for eternity. In fact, we know you will be, God. Thank you again.